Brigadier General Noor Fatema Madam of CMS Dhaka and Chief Pediatric Cardiologist of Lab 8, Cardiac Hospital Dhaka and Chairman of Congenital Heart Disease Foundation, Bangladesh. Respected Senior Consultant of Pediatric Cardiology, Iskar Hospital, Bangladesh, Professor Abdus Abdul Salam, and respected distinguished guests from home and abroad. Assalamu alaikum and good afternoon. I myself, Lieutenant Colonel Mufazzal, welcome you all in this today's Friday sessions of virtual class organized by Congenital Heart Disease Foundation in joint collaboration with Narayana Health and Beximco Pharma Limited. It is my expanded pleasure and opportunity to me to be a moderator of these sessions. And heartfelt thanks to Madam. As a continuous series of classes, today's topics of discussion is management of simple congenital heart disease. Before I go into the sessions, I would like to introduce our today's honored speaker. Our today's speaker, Dr. Prakash Raj, at present is a consultant pediatric cardiology, Narayana Health Institute. And Dr. Prakash Raj is a pediatric cardiology at Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science, Bangalore. He is an MBBS and completed his MD in pediatrics and FMB in pediatrics cardiology. Dr. Prakash is experienced in handling pediatrics and adult congenital heart disease cases, and perform procedure like fetal echocardiography and key intervention cardiology procedure. His field of experience in echocardiography in pediatrics and congenital heart disease, interventional and pediatric and adult congenital heart disease hybrid interventions, and key procedure perform RVOT stenting and ductal stent. He had held various clinical posts, that is clinical assistant in pediatric cardiac ICU in Narayana Health, for senior registered pediatrics, Fortis Hospital, BG Road, Bangalore, fellow in pediatric cardiology, Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science, and senior registered pediatric cardiology, Narayana Institute of Cardiac Science. He has many publications in home and abroad in various international journals. He also is very spoken in various languages in English, Hindi, Kannada, Tamil, Malayalam, and Telugu. He's a very bright person and young, energetic. I would like to invite Dr. Prakash Raj to present his topics today. Dr. Prakash Raj, he will present management of simple congenital heart disease.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Hussain. At the outset, I would want to thank professors for giving me this opportunity, especially the heart of Bangladesh. On to the topic of management of simple CHDs for today. First of all, thanks to all my teachers and mentors for having me do this and for me. Today, I would be covering mainly the acyanotic CHDs and its management with reference to blood flow like atrial septal defect, ventricular septal defects, ductus arteriosus, and obstructive lesions of valvar aortic stenosis, valvar pulmonary stenosis, and coarctation. First of all, we have guidelines which help us to decide on what should be the management procedure for each individual patient. But is it always a commandment that we have to follow? No. The guidelines are generally a guide, and it's not a commandment to follow in terms of management of patients. There are multiple factors which we need to consider in the background of following the guidelines. One is age of presentation, the which in our Southeast Asia is mostly diagnosed in infancy or later based on the symptoms, as compared to Westerners where we follow the guidelines where it's diagnosed either in the fetal or the neonatal, pre-discharged from the in neonatal ward. And also the clinical status where innumerable number of babies present to us in shock, as compared to the Westerners where they generally are diagnosed before the fetal or neonatal age and their to consider the education status and financial status of the parents, because they have to understand the subtle nuances of the decisions we are making, and say we may not be able to push them for single ventricle palliations or cardiac transplantation unless otherwise they are educated and understand what their child is going through and they want to get it done. And also the financial status, because most of the congenital heart defects are not covered by the insurance as compared to the Westerners where everything is covered. And we also need to see the pros and cons of corrective procedures versus palliative, because the long-term prognosis of palliative procedures may not be in sync with what the parents expect for their child. And always we need to discuss the risk versus benefit with the parents, because they always expect a good outcome for their patients, for their babies. So we need always to discuss about the risk and the benefit. And again, with the background of what expertise do we have in our institution, what is the proposition of the team, and will we be able to manage all the complications which may arise in due course of the management of the child. And also we should always have a tie-up with a higher referral center so that they can be safely handed over to the better center if we do not have the expertise in our institute. So considering all this, we should always take the international guidelines with a pinch of salt and always develop what we can manage in our place. So we should always have a consensus local guidelines to follow. And in some cases where the fetal diagnosis is made, the parents are well educated, they can take care of their child, then definitely we need to religiously follow the guidelines in such ideal circumstances. So just a brief note on what are the our investigative armamentarium in our hands. So basically we have a outpatient basic investigations like chest X-ray, echocardiogram, and electrocardiogram. Chest X-ray generally is very non-specific, just to support the diagnosis. The ECG generally can lead to give specific findings, which can lead to narrowing down the diagnosis, differential diagnosis of the congenital heart defects. The gold standard, which is available in the OPD, would be echocardiogram, through which we can do an anatomical and physical physiological diagnosis, which will help us take a decision as to the management. Other ancillary or supportive investigations which add on to the already known diagnosis on echocardiography would be a CT scan, which is best suited for all the extra cardiac anatomy, like in coronaries, aorta, pulmonary artery, collaterals, and coronaries. As per the cardiac MRI, it would be helpful in assessing the ventricular volumes, which in which the echocardiography may not be very sensitive. And we can assess the ejection fraction without much variation. We can assess the QP-QS ratio, any differential QP where there is a stenosis of one pulmonary artery. And main important thing would be a myocardial tissue characterization as per the any presence of scars or aneurysms. And the last would be the cardiac catheterization, which is generally an invasive intervention with its own possible complications. This helps mainly in operability assessment of any shunt lesions. QPQS calculation to see if there is any reversibility of the pulmonary hypertension in cases of shunt lesions. And other additional things would be any additional VSTs or collaterals, which may not be picked up on echocardiogram. So jumping to our commonest, probably the second commonest if we include the bicuspid aortic valve, that is the atrial septal defect. It generally is classified based on the presence of the defect in secondum fossa alveolus or the secondum atrial septal defect, presence of in this thing of the primum atrial septal defect or the partial AV canal defect, the SVC or IVC type sinus venosus defect, and coronary sinus type atrial septal defect. The physiological consequence of any pre-tricuspid shunt is a volume overload on the right heart, leading to due to a left-right shunt across the atrial septum. In this, the grade of shunt generally depends on the relative compliance of the ventricles and not basically on the pulmonary arterial pressures, which is generally true in cases of post-tricuspid shunts. The second thing would be the size of the defect. Once the defect is beyond, say, 8 or 10 millimeters, generally the grade of shunt depends solely on compliance of the right and the left ventricle. Generally, with ASDs, there are quite common associations like partial monomalous pulmonary venous connection, AV valve regurgitation in cases of partial canal, mitral valve diseases, which are generally missed, like Ruttenbacher syndrome is commonly missed when we don't focus specifically on the mitral valve in presence of a secondum ASD. And especially in adults, left ventricle, when there will be left ventricular hypertrophy in cases of chronic hypertension or any presence of restrictive physiology and dysfunction. So all this should be looked into before deciding on the need or the type of mode of intervention in atrial septal defects. So as we all know, as already spoken, the anatomical classification of the atrial septal defect based on the location of the defect. So a special note on ECG in atrial septal defect, generally, even before we hold the echo probe, we can generally have a narrow down of the diagnosis based on the electrocardiogram. So P wave axis is abnormal in sinus venosus defect because of the abnormal positioning of the sinoatrial node. The QRS axis will be left axis in primum defect and counterclockwise loop in a primum defect. The secondum defect generally has 20%, especially in adults, has a prostatite sign, that's a slurring in the limb leads 2 and 3. And the possibility of arrhythmias is higher in cases of primum defect in children in presence of first degree heart block. So coming to the secondum atrial septal defect, we have multiple views through which we can assess the presence, its physiological effect, and the suitability of device closure in transthoracic echocardiogram. I have already annotated the rims of the atrial septal defect. So we generally have to have at least 5 millimeter or more of a rim around the defect, except the aortic rim, which generally is the commonest rim which is deficient. So one of the uncommon form of pre-tricuspid shunt is your IVC type of sinus venosus defect. So in this, you can see the right lower pulmonary vein is directly draining into the right atrium. In this patient, there was an associated secondum defect as well. In the bicaval view, you can see the right lower pulmonary vein, though is connected to the left atrium, there is a defect in the sinus venosus septum leading to drainage of the blood from the right lower pulmonary vein into the RA. Same is here. So in cases of atrial septal defect, the aim of intervention is to reduce the volume overload of the right heart, and with it, improvement in symptoms. And more relevant in adults would be further progression of PAH if the ASD is diagnosed in the later childhood or adulthood. And again, with the reduction of volume overload and prevention of PAH progression, there is prevention of atrial arrhythmias as well. But in cases of patients who have been diagnosed later than 25 to 40 years, the atrial arrhythmia rate is generally not reduced even after closure of the defect. So the indication of closure would be presence of a ASD with left-right shunt with right heart volume overload either diagnosed on echocardiogram or cardiac MRI if needed, without any irreversible pulmonary arterial hypertension. And with without the volume overload or smaller atrial septal defect, it is in presence of any paradoxical embolism, which is having a confirmatory diagnosis. Coming to the timing of intervention, the secondary ESD, the ideal age is to close it between 2 to 4 years of age or at diagnosis whenever it is diagnosed beyond this age. In cases of primary ESD, it is safe to close it earlier because of rapid progression of the cardiac failure and pulmonary arterial hypertension, and because of presence of associated AV valve regurgitation, chances of atrial arrhythmias also increase. And in cases of sinus venosus defect, because of the difficulty of the surgical intervention, it is generally advised to close by 5 years of age. And whenever these defects are diagnosed beyond this ideal age of intervention, it should be electively closed when at diagnosis. A special note for atrial septal defect with pulmonary arterial hypertension. So the new European guideline says if the pulmonary vascular resistance on invasive measurement is 3 to 5 odd units with the associated cubic years of more than 1.5, it's a class 2A indication to close. And in case the PVR is more than 5 odd units but reduces to less than 5 odd units with targeted PAH therapy, that is pulmonary vasodilators and not on table oxygen or nitric oxide reversibility. It is targeted PAH therapy for at least 3 to 6 months. If the PVR reduces to less than 5 and QPQS in the second cardiac catheterization is beyond 1.5 with reduction of PVR less than 5 odd units, we have to consider closing the ASD but with a fenestration. And in cases of PVR more than 5 odd units and which does not reduce with targeted PAH therapy, it's considered Eisenmenger physiology and it's contraindication for closure. So any presence of cyanosis or clubbing in presence of ASD by itself will be Eisenmenger physiology in the absence of any right ventricular outflow tract obstructions. So for atrial septal defects, there is no role for medical management. Only less than 1% of children present with features of low weight gain or sometimes right heart failure, they may be needed to start on diuretics. So the mode of closure would be, except the once secondary ASD where it is suitable for device closure, it would be surgical. So midline sternotomy or mini sternotomy is a standard procedure, and many of the institutes offer a right lateral thoracotomy where the scar would be in the axilla, right axilla, and most of the time it heals without much scar. In cases of secondary ASD where it is technically suitable, where the stretch diameter of the largest diameter of the ASD is less than or equal to 38 with minimum of 4 to 5 millimeter rims except in the aortic rim, it is considered technically suitable. And in the recent past, there is a new technique of using covered stent for closing the SVC type of sinus venosus, which we generally don't do in our institute. So most of the cases for sinus venosus defect will go for a surgery, except in a few institutes where they offer a covered stent. So this is one of the commonest interventional procedure which we do in our institute is a atrial septal defect device closures. There are multiple techniques which have been described. So depending on the presence or borderline rims, there are multiple assisted techniques like a balloon assisted technique, left atrial roof technique. In presence of a need for a larger device, say 34 or 36, you can use a left upper pulmonary vein technique. And in cases of borderline aortic rims, where the device need is smaller, we can use a right upper pulmonary vein technique for device closure. So this is of a patient where it had a central defect where we could use the standard or a left atrial method for closure of the device. So if the ASD is closed at a right age, the chances of progression of pulmonary hypertension and atrial arrhythmias are stopped at, it can be prevented from progression. Next, moving on to the second defect, that is the ventriculoceptal defect. There are multiple classification based on the morphology or based on the surgical specimens or based on the physiological, which we generally use for deciding the timing of intervention. So anatomical subtypes will generally guide on the mode of intervention, possible outcomes and complications, and the expected natural history. The physiological result of a ventricular septal defect type of post-right aspirate shunt is a volume overload on the left heart due to left-right shunt. And the grade of the shunt, as I have already explained, will depend on the ratio of the pulmonary versus systemic vascular resistance. When the defect is large, when the defect is smaller, then the grade of shunt is dependent on the size of the defect. Generally, the smaller the defects, there are more chances of anatomical complications like aortic regurgitation because of aortic cusp prolapse and development of double chambered RV in cases of very restrictive ventricular septal defect, and so is the chances of infective endocarditis. So physiologically, it is classified based on the size of the left heart and the PA pressure vis-a-vis the systemic pressures. So we classify as small VST when the child has no symptoms, the PA pressures are normal, the left heart chambers are normal, and there is no associated cusp prolapse. Moderate ventricular septal defect when the PA pressures are normal because of restricted ventricular septal defect, but there is volume overload on the left heart. And large ventricular septal defect when the ventricular septal defect is non-restrictive, where the PA pressures will be either half or more than two-thirds systemic, and there will be associated dilated left heart with associated congestive cardiac failure. The last one would be Eisenmenger VST, where the pulmonary vascular resistance is deemed more than systemic vascular resistance. So there will be right to left shunting or reversal of shunting with concomitant dilated right heart with associated cyanosis and clubbing. So anatomical classification is based on the location of the VST into supracrystal or infundibular. The type 2 would be perimembranous, and type 3 will be inlet. And these three types are generally suitable for surgical intervention, unless otherwise it's a perimembranous VST, which is away from the tricuspid and the aortic valve. Type 4, the muscular defects, are generally suitable for interventions. So as already spoken, the quantum and direction of shunt depends on the size of VST first when it's restricted. And if the VST is unrestricted, it depends on the systemic and pulmonary vascular resistance ratio. So just a note on how to echocardiographically diagnose the location of the VST, and based on which we can decide which would be the better mode of intervention for that said child. So echocardiographically, in this child, it was a 4-month old child with a large mid-muscular ventricular septal defect, which we could intervene by a hybrid procedure where we did a sternotomy and punctured the heart through the puncture needle, crossed the wire into the left ventricle, and did a paraventricular ventricular septal defect device closure. So in the advantage in this case would be you are avoiding the cardiopulmonary bypass and all its attendant complications. So echocardiographically, again, this was a 14-year-old child with a multiple ventricular septal defect. And another echocardiogram where you can see it's a sub-aortic ventricular septal defect, which is complicated by the prolapse of the aortic cusp with associated aortic regurgitation. This again becomes an indication for intervention irrespective of the left heart or volume overload. So the treatment part depends on the size of the defect, the likelihood of spontaneous closure or decrease in size, say if it's a muscular defect, we can allow time for it to spontaneously close or decrease in size. But in cases of outlet or malaligned VST, we know that it will never close. So the timing of intervention will be decided based on the location of the VST also. And in cases of any involvement of cardiac valves like aortic cusp prolapse causing insufficiency, again becomes a class 1 or class 2A indication for intervention. Medical management for smaller defects does not arise because they do not have any symptoms because of volume overload. In cases of moderate or larger defects, the symptoms will be because of the cardiac failure and increased pulmonary blood flow. In such cases, diuretics can be used as a first line of management, which reduces the pulmonary interstitial edema and reduces the work of breathing. So there will be better weight gain. With that, if the defect is a little more larger, unrestrictive, we can use afterload reduction to offset the reduce the systemic afterload so that less left right shunt happens because of the reduced pulmonary vascular resistance, and hence the quantum of pulmonary over circulation reduces. A thing to note here is generally the pediatricians will jump and use in some of the pulmonary vasodilators like sildenafil or bosentan, ambrisentan. Once you write pulmonary hypertension in your echo report, you have to help and educate them that this is actually counterproductive because they reduce the pulmonary vascular resistance further and increases the pulmonary over circulation, causing more symptoms and pulmonary edema. So the indications for intervention in cases of VST is in cases of small VST, that is no left heart volume overload. In case, but the child also has more than trivial AR because of aortic cusp prolapse, any history of infective endocarditis or subsequent development of double chambered right ventricle, this becomes an indication. In cases of moderate ventricular septal defect, if there is left heart volume overload, even in cases of asymptomatic children, ideal time is between 2 to 5 years. And in cases of symptomatic children who are on medications, it is better to intervene by 2 years of age. In cases of large VST, if the congestive cardiac failure can be reasonably controlled by medications, it can be postponed till 3 to 6 months of age. If say by 3 months, in spite of using multiple medications, the CCF is not controlled, it can be done earlier as well. So again, same which we had already discussed. Again, here the note on cases where the child is older than say 2 to 3 years and has an unrestricted ventricular septal defect. Again, you have to do an invasive cardiac catheterization to assess the pulmonary vascular resistance. So if the pulmonary vascular resistance is less than 3, you can operate. If it's between 3 to 5 and QPQS is more than 1 is 1.5, you can offer surgery. But in case it's the pulmonary vascular resistance is more than 5 units, in spite of having a QPQS of more than 1.5, you can give a trial of pulmonary vasodilators, and if it reverses, then you can try for VST closure. But if it still stays beyond the 5 units, it is better to name the child as Eisenmenger and leave them alone. And this generally has to be taken on an individual case basis rather than following a protocol. So the modes of intervention would be in cases of large defect present in the location of inlet or outlet or subarterial defects, surgery would be preferable. If it is near the aortic valve with or without AR, it's better to opt for surgery. The cons would be cardiopulmonary bypass and its attendant complications, prolonged hospital stay, and a central sternal scar. You can opt for a device in cases of restrictive defects in the perimembranous or the muscular area, which in perimembranous defects where it is away from the aortic valve and the tricuspid valve. If there are adequate rims and the child is more than 8 kg, we can opt for device closure. The advantages being no scar and short recovery period. When there are overlapping features like it's a muscular defect, but it is too large and the child is too small, say less than 8 kilos. So you may not have enough space for device intervention. In such cases, we can opt for a hybrid procedure where we do a sternotomy and perventricularly place a device without the use of a cardiopulmonary defects, cardiopulmonary bypass. Short note on PA band, which is generally in the present era is almost outdated, unless otherwise it's a severe failure to thrive, sick baby, or there is any contraindication for cardiopulmonary bypass, like the child is having sepsis, or in cases of Swiss cheese VSTs in a very small baby. In such cases, PA band can be opted. So just a passing note on interventional VST device closure. So as we all know, we can retrogradely cross into the left ventricle to define the VST, cross from the retrograde, snare the wire and make a atrioventricular, AV loop, and then pass the sheath and close the ventricular septal defect with an appropriate size defect device if the defect is away from the aortic and the tricuspid valve. Just before the release, we generally do a root aortogram and assess the tricuspid valve function on the echocardiogram in cases of perimembranous defects. So sometimes we may have to think differently and approach the ventricular septal defect different from a different site. In this case, it was a lower muscular VST where we had to approach from the right internal jugular vein. And another one case where there was a interrupted IVC, we had difficulty in crossing from right internal jugular vein. So we opted for a hepatic vein access to do the ventricular disc. So this was going, we took help of an interventional radiologist to approach this VST and closed it from the hepatic vein. Once the device is done, while we remove the sheath, the interventional radiologist closes the tunnel through with a coil. So again, if the ventricular septal defect is closed at the appropriate time, there will not be any progression of pulmonary hypertension to a pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. Next would be PDA. Here we'll have to consider two different age groups or two different presentations, that is term versus preterm. That is because the mechanism of failure of closure is different. In term, it is because of abnormal ductal tissue, versus preterm where there's immature ductal tissue, which is still not ready to close. Hence the management option also differs, where we have to opt for a ligation or a device based on suitability in a term baby versus medical closure as a first choice in preterms. And there will be variable clinical presentation as well. In term baby, they become symptomatic if it is large, in presence of large PDA in, with congestive cardiac failure by around 6 to 8 weeks of gestation, 6 to 8 weeks of age, or they generally present asymptomatic because of an incidentally detected murmur. But in cases of preterm, generally, they are symptomatic earlier and even with a restrictive duct as well. So they may present with cardiac failure within the first week. The more premature the baby is, the more earlier they can present. We have seen 26, 27 weeker presenting with cardiac failure within the first week of life. There may be increasing oxygen requirement, because of which your neonatologist will call you for deciding the need for intervention and the possibility of causing intracranial hemorrhage and necrotizing enterocolitis as a complication of PDA in a preterm. The physiological effect again is as any post-tricuspid shunt, that is left heart volume overload with transfer of the systemic pressures into the pulmonary circulation. Here also the quantum of left right shunt depends on ratio of pulmonary vascular to systemic vascular resistance. Considering that the PDA is large. In cases of restrictive PDA, generally the quantum will depend on the size of the PDA. As the pressure head of the systemic pressure is transferred, we call it as a hyperkinetic PH rather than obstructive PH. There will be increased pulmonary venous return, so causing pulmonary venous congestion and subsequent congestive cardiac failure. Again, the physiological classification is helpful to decide the need and timing of intervention. we classify it as large PDA when there is significant left heart volume overload, the child is in CCF with a hyperkinetic severe pulmonary arterial hypertension. In cases of moderate PDA, some degree of restriction would be there. So on echocardiogram, generally it will be showing a peak systolic of more than 2 or 2.5 meters. And there will be some degree of left heart volume overload. No or mild congestive cardiac failure will be there with mild to moderate pulmonary hypertension. In cases of small PDA, there is minimal or no volume overload, no pulmonary hypertension or cardiac failure, but with the presence of any continuous murmur. In cases of silent PDA, none of the left heart volume overload, murmur or PAH is there, and it can only be diagnosed incidentally on a Doppler echo. So in this case, there was a large PDA with a unrestrictive pulmonary blood flow. So the treatment, again, as discussed, depends on is it a term PDA or a preterm PDA. In terms of preterm PDA, treatment would be necessary when the child develops congestive cardiac failure or there is other complications like oxygen requirement or development of necrotizing enterocolitis or intracranial hemorrhage. So the first option would always be a medical therapy where IV indomethacin can be used in the set doses. But the issue with the indomethacin IV would be the chances of renal dysfunction are higher, and the creatinine should be within the normal range by the time the child is 1 week of age. In cases of renal dysfunction where indomethacin cannot be used, ibuprofen oral can be used. But again, the drawback here would be it can increase the chances of necrotizing enterocolitis. And by the time if you have to use ibuprofen, the at least the feed, oral feed should have been established. Recent guidelines have talked about oral paracetamol, but again, the chances of closure is less as compared to the ibuprofen or indomethacin. Indomethacin nearly has a 90% closure rate. Brufen or ibuprofen oral has anywhere between 80 to 90%, and paracetamol anywhere, multiple studies have shown anywhere between 30 to 80%. So it's a very variable chances of closure. But if the baby is sick and you cannot use ibuprofen because of still not established feed, then probably paracetamol as a first choice would be ideal. In case two steps of medical treatment fail, there is always a backup of surgical ligation, and device closures are in vogue in the recent past, where the ampulizer has come up with a piccolo device. But again, the expertise is what will be the limiting factor in doing device closures in a preterm. The medical management, this I'm now talking about the term PDA. So diuretics can be used like in ventricular septal defect, enalapril, or for afterload reduction. And again, to advise the pediatrician not to use pulmonary vasodilators in post-tricuspid shunts. And the modes of intervention would be surgical intervention if the PDA is large by 3 to 6 months of age, if the child is less than 6 kg and it is deemed not suitable for a device closure. Device closure, if it is suitable and child is more than 6 kilos without causing any obstruction in the left pulmonary artery or the arch narrowing, we can opt for a device closure. If the PDA is large and congestive cardiac failure cannot be controlled with medications, 3 to 6 months is a ideal time. In cases of moderate PDA, 6 months to 1 year of age is the ideal time. And in cases of small PDA, that is no volume overload but with a murmur, ideally between 1 to 1.5 year age would be an ideal time for closure. So except for probably large PDA between 3 to 6 months and less than 6 kg, all the others, depending on the echocardiographic anatomy, if the device anatomy is suitable for device, device would be the first choice procedure. Again, with respect to the pulmonary hypertension, if the child presents later, you always have a additional diagnosis, well, like we can do a interventional catheterization and block the ductus with a balloon or a device and check for operability. If there is a separation of the systemic and pulmonary pressures, then you can consider it deemed fit and closed with a device and put on pulmonary vasodilators. I have a couple of traces which I would discuss in subsequent slides. So standard operating procedure, you can cross retrogradely from the aorta and put a device antegradely from the IVC. So as I was talking about this was one of the cases, we had a large PDA presenting around 2 years of age. So you can see there is diastolic equalization of the pink is the systemic and the blue is the pulmonary pressures. There is a diastolic equalization. Once we put a device, there is significant and unequivocal separation of the systemic pressure. Systolic and diastolic goes up and immediately the pulmonary systolic and diastolic comes below. So here this tracing was saved when we were putting a device. So again, here the diastolic equalization is there, and immediately on balloon occlusion or device occlusion, there is separation of the systemic and the pulmonary arterial pressure trace. So as discussed, this is one of the additional investigations we can do to decide on the operability vis-a-vis the ventricular septal defect. In ventricular septal defect, we don't have any other option other than giving a pulmonary vasodilators, specific therapy, sildenafil, ambrisentan, and recheck the pulmonary vascular resistance after 3 to 6 months. But in cases of PDA, we can directly check occluding the PDA. But only issue here would be, should be only a presence of only a PDA and not any VST PDA type of presentation. Next, coming to the bicuspid aortic valve. Again, the physiological effect is a pressure overload on LV and with progressive increase in LV pressure, which can lead to dysfunction in the long run. Anatomical description is anyway well known. The diagnostic criteria for severe stenosis has to be noted. Doppler gradients of peak instantaneous of more than 4 meters per second or 64 millimeter mercury, mean gradient of more than 40. So these are the easier steps to classify the AS based on severity. So one case which we had seen presented to us with severe ventricular dysfunction with the bicuspid aortic valve, the gradients were beyond 4 meters per second. So it was a severe case of aortic stenosis. So again, the indications in cases needing immediate intervention would be a newborn with severe AS, and if it's ductal dependent, in newborns, surgical valvulotomy can be considered. If surgeons are not there or do not approve of surgical valvulotomy, balloon aortic valvulotomy can be attempted. In cases of children or children with LV dysfunction, irrespective of the gradient, immediate intervention is mandated. In cases to consider elective intervention is any symptomatic or asymptomatic with severe AS, that is echo-Doppler gradient of peak instantaneous more than 4 meters per second or more than 40 millimeter mercury mean gradient, or peak to peak invasive gradient more than equal to 50 millimeter of mercury would be considered for elective BAV. In cases of symptomatic, which can be attributed to the aortic stenosis or in the presence of ECG changes at rest or exercise, even if the Doppler gradient is less than 4 meters per second, you can consider it. If the peak to peak gradient is more than 40 millimeter of mercury. In cases of asymptomatic without any ECG changes with a peak to peak more than 40 millimeter of mercury, then you can consider it. If the patient wants to, if it's a child wants to, or a patient in a adolescent age wants to pursue competitive sports. So such cases we can consider elective balloon aortic valvotomy. So same thing which we already spoke, and European Society also also considers in cases of low surgical risk to intervene even if the function is good and the gradient is not in the severe range. So in cases of aortic stenosis, medical management has limited or no role. Only close follow-up can be planned to assess any progress. Sometimes beta blockers can be used if the child or the patients are not ready and wants to come back after a few weeks, which only reduces the chances of sudden cardiac death. The modes of intervention would be surgical, where valvotomy is the better choice in a newborn. But in cases of dysfunction in a newborn, the surgeons may not be keen to go for a valvotomy, surgical valvotomy. And Ross procedure for newborns or valve replacement in a later age group, in an adolescent age group, valve replacement or Ross would be a good option. Considering that the valve is not fit for balloon aortic valvotomy. In cases of balloon aortic valvotomy where it is suitable, this would be the first choice except in the newborn. And in newborn, if there is associated dysfunction, definitely again balloon interventional valvotomy would be better approached. As for the approach and the access, retrograde from the femoral artery or sometimes the surgical cut down of carotid artery, because you will not be able to cross the aortic valve by femoral artery, you can attempt a carotid artery. And antegrade through the IVC if you have a PFO or AST, more so in a cases of newborn with dysfunction. We generally also use a double balloon technique, where it is easier to, we can do away with smaller sheets. So two balloons when used simultaneously will give a total diameter of 82%, 82 to 84%. Like if you use five balloons, which will be 10, it will give effective diameter of 8.2 to 8.4 millimeter. So in bigger children where we are sure that he will need repeated intervention, we use the balloon, double balloon technique, so that we can use a smaller sheath. So standard procedure, it's a domain pulmonary valve, retrogradely crossed, and appropriate. Generally, we go up to 90% balloon valve diameter ratio under rapid ventricular pacing. So here again, it was a 7-year-old child with a big annulus and dilated root. So we ended up using two double balloons so that we could use only four French sheets in the femoral artery. Otherwise, single balloon probably would have had to use seven or eight sheets in the femoral artery. So next, coming to the valvular pulmonary stenosis. So again, the gradient ratio is same as the aortic stenosis. More than 4 meters per second, peak instantaneous would be the classification for severe stenosis. So irrespective of it's a doming valve or a dysplastic valve, we generally opt for a balloon aortic valvotomy as the first and probably only procedure may be needed in such cases, except in cases of dysplastic pulmonary valve where the chances of success of balloon valvotomy are lesser as compared to the doming pulmonary valve. So coming to the interventions, immediate intervention, emergent intervention may be needed in a newborn with severe PS and which is ductal dependent circulation. Or in cases of infants or children where there is RV dysfunction, irrespective of the grade of the gradient. And elective pulmonary valvotomy to be considered where asymptomatic or symptomatic with severe stenosis, that is more than 4 meters per second peak instantaneous echo gradient, and in neonate or infant with any degree of PS with mild hypoxia in the presence of ASD due to hypoplasia of RV, even if there is a normal RV function. So even if it is moderate stenosis, it is better to balloon such cases. And in cases of dysplastic valve, probably it would be ideal to give a shot on balloon pulmonary valvotomy, so it is classified under class 2B indication. But dysplastic pulmonary valve, probably it would be successful in only 20 to 40%, and later on maybe other 60% would end up in the surgeon's table. Surgical valvotomy or surgical repair may be needed where the child is symptomatic with severe PS and dysplastic pulmonary valve. Again, in such cases, first option of balloon can always be attempted. As already told, failed BPV in cases of severe PS with dysplastic pulmonary valve, or where there is right ventricular systolic pressure of 80 millimeter of mercury, there is associated RV dysfunction, there is torrential right to left shunt across the AST, or there is decreased exercise capacity. Once the BPV is failed, we can send it for surgical valvotomy or valve replacement. For balloon pulmonary valvotomy, it's a standard IVC approach. IVC, right atrium, right ventricle and PA. So both injections and balloon can be done from the single IVC access. In cases of neonates or infants or in presence of severe tricuspid regurgitation, it becomes a little tedious to cross from the IVC RA to RV because of the tricuspid regurgitation or lack of appropriate catheters to cross from the RA to the RV. In such cases, right internal jugular vein is a very good access. It will have a easier crossing and better control over the balloon. Again, here single versus double balloon can be used. In adults, sometimes annulus will be 25-26. So in such cases, the appropriate 120% or 120% balloon may not be available. So we can use a double balloon technique to intervene in such cases. A couple of cases on that. So it was an infant where crossing from the RARV, IVC RARV was difficult. So we opted for a RIJV. If you opt for RIJV, the control on the balloon is better as compared to IVC. In IVC cases, because RV is, especially if the function is good, if you cannot rapid pace, then controlling the balloon will be, the balloon will be bobbing in and out of the RV. So controlling from the IVC will be difficult. So in such cases, even in adults, we generally do one balloon from the right internal jugular vein and second balloon from the IVC. So coming to the last lesion, the coarctation of aorta. The physiological effect of coarctation is a pressure overload on LV, like in aortic stenosis. But if it develops rapidly in the neonatal age, there will be rampant LV dysfunction, progression of LV dysfunction. And if it goes unnoticed, it can end up in cardiogenic shock. Long-term, slow progression will result in left ventricular hypertrophy, upper body hypertension, and development of collaterals, which may lead to missing of this lesion on clinical examination. The indication of intervention is gradient, which is peak-to-peak invasive gradient of more than 20 millimeter of mercury. And if the gradient is less than 20 millimeter of mercury peak-to-peak, then in presence of LV dysfunction, where we can attribute it to the coarctation, and in presence of any upper limb hypertension or collateral formation or left ventricular hypertrophy, it becomes a class 2A indication for intervention. In presence of hypertension, if there is upper limb hypertension, if there is more than 50% narrowing of the coarctation isthmus relative to the aorta at the diaphragm, it becomes a class 2A indication. So upper limb hypertension, LV dysfunction, LV hypertrophy, or a more than 50% narrowing of the aorta, these are the indications which will help us decide the intervention. The timing of intervention, again, it would be immediate at diagnosis if there is associated LV dysfunction, congestive cardiac failure, or upper limb hypertension. If the baby presents the ideal scenario, it may be beyond 6 months. If there is no, say it presents at 3 months, if there is no LV dysfunctions, congestive cardiac failure, or with mild hypertension, upper limb hypertension, you can consider it beyond 6 months. If it presents around 6 months to 1 year without any cardiac failure, LV dysfunction, or upper limb hypertension, you can electively consider it with a close follow-up by around 1 to 2 years of age. So the modes of intervention would be surgical in cases of infants and neonates. It would be native coarctation with in the infant, early infancy or neonate. The best option would be surgical, where they can do a resection with end-to-end anastomosis, subclavian flap iotaplasty, or prosthetic patch iotaplasty. In adults where the anatomy is not suitable, surgical options would be interposition graft or the jump graft. The interventional procedure can be balloon angioplasty or stenting based on the age and weight of the child. In cases of neonate, as already discussed, surgery would be the first choice. If neonate is presenting in shock, balloon angioplasty can be considered if the surgeon is not ready to take the risk. Infant with native coarctation, there is equal opportunity for surgical versus balloon. So always in our institute, if it's infant with native coarctation, we generally send it for surgery. And if it is infants with recoarctation, then balloon would be the first choice. In cases of child less than 25 kilos in a native coarctation, again, balloon versus surgery, with first option being balloon angioplasty. In cases of children less than 25 kgs with recoarctation, balloon would obviously be the first choice. And any child more beyond 10 years or 25 kgs or an adult with native or recoarctation, stenting would be the first choice. So this is one of the pullback gradient from the ascending aorta to the thoracic aorta. So you can see a gradient step down of the pressures in this child, almost up to the 40 millimeter of mercury. Again, this is a juxtaductal coarctation in an infant. The gradient was around 45 on the echo with diastolic tailing. So it had a ventricular dysfunction, so we had to opt for a balloon aortic valvotomy, a balloon coarctoplasty, sorry. So approach to the standard balloon coarctoplasty is retrograde, do an injection, and balloon from the, generally we go with the average of the balloon size would be average of the pre-coarctation and the diameter of the descending thoracic aorta at the diaphragm. We take an average of that and do a balloon. So post balloon, there was an intimal tear, but we followed it up for nearly 3 to 6 months, which did not progress. The child did well after this procedure. It needed only one coarctation balloon. There was some gradient after 6 months, but it was considered less than, there was no diastolic tailing. Around 2.5 meter peak instantaneous gradient was there without any diastolic tailing. So stenting any adult with native or recoarctation, or child more than 10 years, more than 25 kilos with native or recoarctation, coarctation stenting would be the first and only choice. So here we had approached from the femoral artery. So because of the gothic type of arch and a huge aneurysmal postductal post coarctation aorta, this doesn't look very great, but from a gradient of around 35 peak to peak, it became less than 10 post procedure. In such some of the children, because the femoral artery is small, and we thought in this case we would not be able to use a appropriate size sheath, we ended up doing from the carotid cut down. Surgically, we had a left carotid artery cut down. Through that, we put a 9 French sheath, and through the introducer sheath only, we could directly put the stent. One advantage of using carotid cut down or carotid sheath is you have a better control over the stent and balloon. As compared to a femoral approach, where you have to cross with the sheath till the ascending aorta and then unsheath the stent before deploying. So sometimes when we approach from the femoral artery, because of the anti-grade blood flow, the stent and balloon can get milked into the descending aorta. So one of the advantages of trying from the carotid artery is you have a better control over the stent and balloon ensemble. So these are the two guidelines which I have used extensively in preparing this talk. Again, I would again tell the audience to have a consensus statement, a consensus guideline in your own institute or in your country, so that everything is standardized and we don't have to fall back on the international guidelines, because international guidelines always take one drawback with us would be we are not in the ideal scenario with respect to presentation of the patient, patient party, that is the parents, because they have to have a deep pocket, and presence of expertise in our respective institutes. Thank you. I would be happy to answer any questions anyone has.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prakash. You have delivered a very good lectures. Indeed, it was a vast and details, including procedure and data.
Mofaddal.
Madam.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
I'm on the way to airport, so I just want to say few words and then I will leave the webinar, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Prakash for his excellent presentation. Actually, the topics he has discussed today are the main issues for the pediatric cardiologist. We all are doing these kind of interventions every day, and all the cases in our cath labs are like ASD, VSD, PDA, device closure, balloon valvoplasty, coarctoplasty, stenting. So the topics which I discussed today usually cover about, like, if you consider VSD is 30% of all congenital heart disease, then 8 to 10% is ASD, PDA is about 8%, pulmonary stenosis like 8%. So if you add all these, we'll find that almost 60% heart disease are these kind of diseases, and there is very good chance of interventions, percutaneous interventions on all these kind of diseases, which he has discussed today. Other than few exceptions, like even some diseases which were contraindication are coming into the contraindication gradually. For example, sinus venosus ASD can be closed by the stent in good centers. Then now perimembranous BSD, even doubly committed BSD, we are closing sometimes. So those who are contraindication, they are also becoming indication in course of time. Now about, I just want to say a few words about one of the management guideline and what he was telling, that every center must have, or in every country must have their own guideline. And this is very true. We actually can follow international guideline or even the guideline of the countries who have good armamentarium of equipment and good specialist skilled cardiac surgeons and all that, or modify our the need of the patient and according to the availability of the resources. So that is very true what he was mentioning. And we are following, for example, he was telling that neonatal coarctation, if it is a native, they refer the case usually to the surgeon. Any surgeon, most of the surgeon, they are not doing neonatal. So for last since beginning of 1998, I am doing neonatal balloon coarctoplasty, and our outcome is very good. And by doing the same thing for a long time, we have our skill expertise on that, and we actually don't face any complication. So this is one of the things. And another thing he was telling, in the management of large left to right shunt lesions with pulmonary hypertension, any kind of large left to right shunt lesion like ASD, VSD, or PDA, there is flow-related pulmonary hypertension initially. The pulmonary hypertension is due to extra flow of blood, and we know that QP, any pressure is equal to flow into resistance. So in the initial part of the pulmonary hypertension, flow factor is the main one. But later on, it becomes the resistance factor. So we have to understand whether the pulmonary hypertension is mainly due to the flow or maybe due to some resistance. So those who are due to the resistance, additional factor of resistance, in those cases, we use pulmonary vasodilator. Sometimes we even see that there is right to left shunt. And even sometimes in newborn, there is physiological pulmonary hypertension up to 6 weeks of age. And then these newborn, they continue with this physiological hypertension with increased pulmonary vascular resistance, which is physiological. But they continue because of the large shunt as pathological later on after 6 weeks. So in those kind of cases, we use pulmonary vasodilator. And one of the logic that pulmonary vasodilator will cause pulmonary edema. Actually, we use also diuretics at the same time, sometimes digitalis, and also pulmonary, also the enalapril or AC inhibitor, which cause systemic vasodilatation. So while you are using all these drugs together, there is very little chance of pulmonary edema. So there is a misunderstanding that never use, but it is not never. Initial stage in flow-related hypertension, you should not give pulmonary vasodilator, but if it is resistance-related, you have to give that. And at the same time, you are giving other drugs also for combating pulmonary edema, for combating congestive heart failure. So there is no problem. And one thing is this medicine is evidence-based. What you are reading in a book is not an evidence alone. What you are doing every day is an evidence. So from our evidence, we are seeing that in case of increased vascular resistance, this drug we use and we are getting a lot of benefit, especially in the hospitals where there is no surgeon to do these kind of cases. Especially in our country, where for pulmonary hypertensive cases, most of the cases are refused by our surgeons. So up to this, I just want to stop. Thank you very much, Dr. Prakash, for your excellent presentation. And this presentation is really will be a great help for our students. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
I'm not seeing any questions here in the question box. If anyone from the panelists, do you want to say anything? Any open questions from the participants?
Good evening. This is Dr. Dabbar from Dhaka Shishu Hospital. I have a question to Prakash sir. First of all, I give special thanks to Professor Brigadier General Luna Khatam Madam, Independence Award, for arranging such a timely, dependable e-learning course for all of the pediatric cardiologists of our country. I have a question to Prakash sir. You have mentioned about cover distant closure of the sinus venosus type of ASD. A newer procedure. What special technique used during to cover this sinus venosus type of ASD by cover distance?
Just want to make sure we don't do it in our institute, but Dr. Sivakumar from Madras Medical Mission is a pioneer in that field. So whatever the covered stent is available, they generally, the sinus venosus defect is such that the common wall between the SVC and the right upper pulmonary vein is what is lacking. So they just cover the common wall through the placement of a covered stent in the SVC. So it automatically redirects the right upper pulmonary vein flow into the LA, which is already connected to the LA. So we don't do it. It's many of the institutes do it. Presently in India, Dr. Sivakumar Kothanam is the pioneer in that, Madras Medical Mission.
I have another question. What management protocol for treatment of RV failure in case after balloon valvuloplasty in critical pulmonary stenosis in unit?
Once the afterload is relieved, that is the pulmonary valvulotomy is done, generally you don't need anything else with time, unless otherwise the right ventricular stretch injury has occurred and its end stage dysfunction. Unless this is there, it will generally improve in pediatrics. Say in severe pulmonary stenosis, undiagnosed, unintervened, till if it reaches adulthood, after BPV, the RV may not recover completely in adults. But in pediatrics, once this is done, even if there is a fair bit of atrial septal defect, that also has been known to close with time. So you don't need any medications to treat RV dysfunction after relieving the afterload in pulmonary stenosis.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Is there any question from the participants? Dr. Ashfaq? Left-hand Ashfaq, do you have any questions?
Okay, I don't have any comment now, but nice to see Dr. Prakash. It's a long time since we departed from Narana back in 2012. Nice to see
you.
And hope to interact with you in future also, Prakash.
Sure, thank you.
Any comments, dear audience and our panelists? I think there is no questions so far. And Dr. Prakash, I have one question. When there is a bidirectional shunt in case of BSD, at that time, can you use the pulmonary vasodilator in that situations?
Yes, the guidelines say so. Unless otherwise the patient is clearly cyanosed and clubbed. In that cases, anyway, depending on symptoms, you'll have to start pulmonary vasodilators early. If you are asking in a child who's not cyanosed or clubbed, saturations are 90-92, bidirectional shunt in across a VST. Again, the guideline says do a cardiac catheterization. See if the pulmonary vascular resistance is less than 3 to 5 or more than 5. If it is anything more than 3, start pulmonary vasodilators 3 to 6 months. Call them after 6 months. Again, cap them, see if any reduction in the pulmonary vascular resistance. If it is beyond 5 and reduces to less than 5 wood units, then offer surgery.
Thank you very much. Dr. Rahul Jabbar, Amas Vijay, there is no attendee, Dilruba Jawan, Krishna. I have one announcement. There is in the next sessions, Professor Abdul Salam from the Square Hospital. He will take the right and left heart syndrome management, symptoms and management. And with this, I want to give special thanks to Dr. Prakash Raj for this excellent deliberation of this today's lectures. I think all the students and all the participants will get benefited from these lectures. Thank you all for nice participants.
I think we can stop.
Yes, thank you very much.